Hello YouTube, Hacker Daniel here. For many centuries, mankind has sought ways to transmute materials like turn lead into gold. Many scientists in the Middle Ages committed their lives to finding out the secret. The secret was never found, until now, as I have found a way to turn plastic into steel. All you have to do is take out some plastic, sprinkle some salt onto it, then some pepper. Then you buy a steelbook, replace them, and boom, steel. The steelbook, many a collector's favorite way of packaging movies, music, garden dirt, and of course games. The steelbook, by some also called the steel case, has become somewhat of a standard within the gaming industry when it comes to special editions, collector's editions and the like. It's essentially just a game case, but made out of metal. Despite being them called steelbooks, they are usually not made out of actual steel, but are rather made out of other cheaper materials like tin. But that doesn't mean that they feel cheap, as when it comes to game packaging, it doesn't get more premium than the steelbook, which is why they're also so often included in collector's editions. I mean, nowadays it's rare to see a game or movie collector's edition without one of these bad boys, and because of that, collecting steelbooks has become as a goal in and of itself to some. Which is understandable, as some of these steelbooks are pure beauty in form of a rectangle. Usually they'll feature different artwork on the front and back than the regular plastic game case, and because they don't have all sorts of legal trash on the steelbook, as that's usually already on the box that the collector's edition comes in, designers can go all out with the design, resulting in some amazing steelbooks with very unique designs, like this one, which came with The Legend of Zelda Link's Awakening, that comes in the form of an actual Game Boy playing the original Game Boy game. But for every Link's Awakening, there's of course also a Luigi's Mansion 3, where they just barf the cover art of the original game on the steelbook. To be fair, they implemented some glow-in-the-dark on this one, making it at least 10% more unique, but still, an original design would have been nice. Speaking of design, usually the design of these things is done by the company Scanavo, on instructed commission of the client, in this case Nintendo. Scanavo, who runs the site steelbook.com, actually praises these things like they're the new messiah, saying that there's no better canvas on which to showcase artwork and that they're the most highly desirable form of media packaging. And at least in my opinion, they aren't at least half wrong. I mean, the steelbooks they produce always do feel very premium, and it gives the game in question this special feeling when you can care about it enough to put it in a special metal case. The company that runs steelbook.com is by and large the only one around town who produces these things. There are others who produce metal casings for media, but more often than not, those steel cases are just inferior in quality and feel cheap and usually need these wonky plastic inserts to even hold the disc, like with this Rise of the Tomb Raider steel case. But when we're talking about Nintendo games, it seems that they've basically been working with Scanavo since the dawn of time, aka the Wii era. Before that, it was very rare for a game to come in anything but a plastic or paper box like they're on the retail shelves. But it did happen from time to time, like for example during the NES to N64 era, Nintendo had a tendency to sometimes make cartridges for their systems out of a special metal. These special cartridges were usually given away as prizes and are very coveted in this day and age. During the GameCube era, there wasn't much in terms of metal packaging, save for this small elusive The Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess steel case. It isn't really clear which company produced these for Nintendo, but it sure as hell wasn't Scanavo, as this steel case also needs plastic trash in it in order to hold a disc. The one other relatively well-known metal packaging available during the GameCube era was this United States GameStop exclusive Resident Evil 4 one, which isn't really per first party of Nintendo, but it was a GameCube exclusive for a while. This edition was called the Collector's Tin Edition, and it was a tin box with both the game and artbook in it. This was also not an official steelbook, but it didn't really predate the official ones by too much time, as during the end of the Wii era, Nintendo finally got a hold of their game and hired Scanavo to produce some pretty high quality and cool steelbooks. Definitely the most well-known steelbook of the late Wii era is this one, which came with the Metroid Prime trilogy in the United States, holding the disc and a few more extras for the game. But less well known are these two steelbooks for The Legend of Zelda Skyward Sword. Both these steelbooks are relatively rare and in good condition will cost you a pretty penny. I personally got a hold of this Canadian black steelbook, which I personally think has a very nice design and is definitely the most well known steelbook of the two. The second one was a very limited European exclusive steelbook, which in my opinion has a garbage design. It literally has the regular Wii box art barfed onto it, and it has the Wii logo on the front for fuck's sake, and even has all the legal mumbo jumbo on the back panel. And in my opinion, that's pretty lame. The final known first party Wii steelbook is this Xenoblade Chronicles one, which also seems to have been European exclusive, and looking at this, I think we can say it together by now. This has a garbage design, because just like the European Skyward Sword book, it literally just has the Wii cover art copy-pasted onto it on the front, including the logo, which is, say it with me now, extremely lame. Now, lucky for us Europeans, Nintendo definitely stepped up their game during the Wii U and 3DS era. During this era, many of Nintendo's first-party releases actually received steelbooks, from Super Mario Bros. U to Mario Kart 8 to Xenoblade Chronicles and to Smash Bros. In addition to that, they also had custom steelbooks made for the 3DS, starting out with these apparently France-exclusive ones dubbed the Pack Collector Editions, which they had made for Mario Kart 7, Super Mario Land 3D and Super Mario Bros. 2. These things are weird. Only a limited amount of them got made, and only in France it seems, and some in Canada. They don't fit with your collection at all, as these are the size of regular Blu-ray cases and simply have the plastic case jammed into them. Like, what's the goal here if you're not going to hold the cartridge in the steelbook? Luckily, Nintendo redeemed themselves later, when they had Scanavo made custom 3DS steelbooks in the latter half of the 3DS's life. These things are sleek and actually have the size of a normal game case, fitting in neatly with the collection. These custom ones were mostly made for the majority of the first party releases during the latter half of the 3DS's life, like Majora's Mask, Metroid Samus Returns, and oh yeah, literally every Pokemon game since Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire. And now, in the present day, it seems that Nintendo is hellbent on including these things with nearly every first party collector's edition, as almost all major games on the release schedule since December 2017 have gotten one, with the first custom Nintendo Switch steelbook being made for Xenoblade Chronicles 2. After which Nintendo really couldn't stop, as they included one in nearly every major release with a collector's edition since. I mean, even Daemon X Machina, the most forgettable game of 2019, got one, with some games without a collector's edition actually still getting one that were sometimes just exclusive with certain retailers, like this one for Luigi's Mansion 3 and Mario Kart 8 Deluxe. Since there's a lot, and I mean a lot of steelbooks for the Switch era, here are some of my personal favorites. The first one being the Mario Kart 8 Deluxe steelbook. This, the shade of red in combination with the artwork, just makes me squeal. Then the Link's Awakening one. I mean, come on, it's a Game Boy. It ain't getting much better than this. The Xenoblade Chronicles 2 one, which just has really good artwork that fits the game. The Mario Maker steelbook. I mean, you can slide a plastic overlay on this thing to quote-unquote build your own level on this steelbook. That's just fun. And finally, the one for Pokemon Let's Go Pikachu and Eevee. I mean, this artwork, I just like it. Now, the final thing I wish to cover is that while Mario Kart 8 got a GameStop exclusive steelbook in retrospect far after the game's release, they never made one for The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild or Super Mario Odyssey, which honestly is a shame, and I really don't get why they haven't done it, as these games definitely deserve to have their own premium packaging. I mean, come on, if you think about it, Daemon X Machina is worth a steel case, and they made three different ones for Pokemon Sword and Shield. I think you can spare an intern to design a steelbook for those games. I mean, you don't even need to, as I already did it for you, and I produced them myself using them decal and crafting materials. I mean, look at the screen, even I can do it. Why can't Nintendo, for Miyamoto's sake? So yeah, that's basically everything about Nintendo's first party steelbooks. I thought I'd be done with this after like 3 minutes, but it took just a little bit longer, over 8 minutes. Maybe if I didn't mention Daemon X Machina like 3 times in this video, it would be shorter, but like I'm the only one who has even mentioned this game in 2020, so perhaps with that, I can just deduct this one on my taxes as a charity. That said, I hope to see you all in the next time when I cover some more Nintendo history. See you later.